Hello and good morning, everybody, and welcome to new seminar organized by Naturgy Foundation, as always with the aim of addressing the most relevant issues related with energy, environment, and sustainability. This occasion, we will focus on the analyzing the impact on industry of the measures adopted by the European Union these recent years in the within the framework of the Green Deal. And of course, we will talk about the future and the measures to be adopted in the future. Well, it's clear that industry is key to the development of the society as generator of wealth and the employment, and ensuring its permanence is essential. It's also clear that it's a very diverse sector, but in any case, energy is always fundamental. Its transformation, the transformation of industry towards a net zero green economy, is a major challenge. Now, these days, we are living a very special moment, a lot of news these days, especially yesterday, with a new commission, imminent entry, this new commission, and it seems that it's clear that one of the main objectives or areas of concern will be related with the competitiveness of our industry, of course, while preserving all the environment and climate objectives. But it seems that we will focus on the competitiveness of our industry. Okay, with this environment, Naturgy Foundation considered that it will be several weeks ago that it would be a good idea how to analyze the impact of this legislation in our industry, not to considering the current situation, but trying to help for the debate in the near future to come. With this objective, to try to provide information for that rigorous or serious debate, we always count on the most relevant experts, and in this occasion we count on Christopher Jones for the preparation of the document that is going to be presented today. Well, trying to introduce Christopher Jones is, I would say, that is complicated, almost impossible, because of his enormous experience. But I will highlight that he's part-time lecturer at Front School of Regulation and principal energy regulatory and antitrust at Baker McKenzie, and former deputy director general for energy in the European Commission. In today's session, just after a presentation of the main points of the document by Christopher Jones, we will have the opportunity to have a roundtable moderated also by Christopher with the participation of two great personalities with in-depth knowledge, not only about the energy sector, but also about the functioning of the European bodies, which is really relevant these days, such as Klaus-Dieter Bronchar and Andries Pivas. Also, it is complicated to introduce them, but I will highlight Klaus-Dieter Bronchar, this former Deputy Director General for Energy and the European Commission, and its senior energy advisor at Baker McKenzie in Brussels. And Andries Pivals is he's a former European Union Energy Commissioner and part-time professor at the Front School of Regulations. Thank you very much to all of you for your presence and availability. I am sure that we will have a very interesting debate. The issue is of great relevance, and the level of the experts is the first class. Nothing more from my side. I want also to add my thanks to all those who have shown interest in this session. It's almost 500 people, and indicate that you can send your questions through the platform enabled for this purpose, and that the document that is going to be presented today is available in the Naturgy Foundation website in its English and Spanish version for your download for free. Nothing more, so let's start to the session and the debate. Christopher, the floor, thank you very much again, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Manuel, for your kind introduction, and thank you to the Naturgy Foundation for organizing this very topical discussion. I'd like to do two things in this brief overview. First is to set the scene on how the Green Deal is likely to impact industry over the next few years, because it's far greater than almost any industry person that I meet actually realizes. because people tend to take what's been done in the Green Deal, little bits of it in isolation. But in order to really understand what will be the impact on companies, you have to look at it in a complete way, in a holistic way. And we'll try and do that a little bit today. But I think that's very important. But when you put it all together and try and project this in 3 or 4 years' time, you realize that, oh, hang on a minute, this is going to be far more impactful than I might have realized before. And I might want to think about the way in which I'm preparing and from an industrial perspective for the real impact of the Green Deal. Because as we will see, until now, it hasn't really had the teeth that it will have in 3 or 4 years. And I would also like to make some preliminary remarks on the question for the next commission to set the scene for our discussion, because the next commission has realized, President von der Leyen has realized, that the impact of the Green Deal on industry is now becoming extremely important. And that is why one of the key priorities for the next commission that the president has indicated is the clean industrial deal. So in other words, how do we green our economy whilst keeping and increasing our energy intensive and other industry? And that is the conundrum that is facing us. So first of all, just let me share my screen and a couple of slides. So this is what the Green Deal looks like. This is what I would call the heat map of the Green Deal. It is basically all the provisions that have been adopted. The only one that has not yet really been adopted is the Energy Tax Directive in the middle. But if you look at this in its completeness, one starts to see the real effect that this will bring in terms of companies. Now, it's impossible given the time that we have today, I only intend to speak for 20 minutes, to look at all of them. But I would like to focus on three things. One is the emissions trading system, the second is renewable energy, and the third part one is on the right-hand side of this, what I call heat map, which is supply chain governance, due diligence, environmental and social governance. Because these are the three things that will have most immediate effect. So let's look at them one by one. Okay. So we all know what the emissions trading system is. It's very simple. It says you take all the industry that is responsible for emitting industrial greenhouse gas emissions, very simple, and then you say, okay, in 2005, what is the total emissions that they have emitted? Okay, very good. Let's say it's 100, okay? And then by 2050, 2040 or whatever date, these will have to be zero, okay? So I would say, okay, in 2005, they had 100 emissions, and every year we will reduce the number of emissions that are available to industry, and we will auction off all the emissions that are available. So in year one, they auction 100, year two, they auction 90, in year three, 75, 70, etc. So for every ton that you emit, you have to buy an allowance, a certificate. Okay, and logically, as you remove them from the system, the price goes up. So far, so good. Okay, now, until now, the price of the ETS emissions has varied between 20 a couple of years ago, 5 years ago, and 100. It's now between 70 and 80. Now, why has this not really, we haven't heard people screaming about the ETS. We haven't heard people saying this is hurting industry. So the question is why? And that is the following reason, and it's called carbon leakage. Because what if the EU would say to, I don't know, our steel industry, our chemicals industry, that you have to cover all your emissions by ETS certificates, 100 euros a ton, whereas the importers don't. The only thing that would happen would be EU industry would close and you would import your stuff rather than producing it in the EU, which makes no sense whatsoever, because all you're doing then is encouraging you move from production from the EU and you move it to somewhere else, which has lower environmental and greenhouse gas standards, and you increase the transport. Therefore, you simply lose jobs in the EU and increase greenhouse gases because of the imports. Makes no sense at all. So what the EU has done is until now is for those sectors in carbon leakage, steel, cement, chemicals, basically all the energy intensive sectors, they have received their emissions allowances for free until now. The electricity sector has not, okay? And so what you've seen is the industrial sector, okay, if you look at how much greenhouse gas has moved, the industrial sector hasn't really reduced much emissions. The sector that has reduced the emissions is the electricity system. And so with the closing of coal, with the increase of renewables, we're seeing emissions going down, okay? And so you see this one, which says the emissions, is actually pretty close to the actual allowances that have been purchased and the freely allocated ones that have been going down, okay? But here's the problem. The longer that you allow freely allocated allowances, okay, the less it's possible to reduce emissions, because at the moment, the ETS has not been reducing emissions. So what has the EU done? The EU has said, okay, we've got to deal with this. We can't have free emissions until 2050. So we're going to do something called the Carbon Border Adjustment Mechanism. So in other words, what that means is we are going to take these industrial sectors. We are not going to give them free allowances anymore. Okay. But what we are going to do is, as they are obliged to buy ETS allowances, we will expose imports to the same thing. So steel, for example, is a CBAM sector. The sectors in the CBAM sector are steel, iron, cement, fertilizers, electricity, hydrogen, basically. Okay. And so progressively, as we move to 2024, these sectors are going to have to buy ETS certificates, okay? And when you import steel, iron, cement, etc., you will have to pay the embedded ETS emissions, okay? So that's one reason why, between now and 2034, industry is going to start really feeling the pain of the ETS. Because until now, they've just had free allowances, which is basically, they've even made profit out of this. So in the future, because of this CBAM and the ETS, all of a sudden, these companies, progressively until 2034, will have to buy allowances, okay? So that's one reason why this is going to really impact, okay? The second reason is, look at the path. So this is the path at which ETS allowances will be taken out of the system. You remember, I said 90, 85, 80, da da da. This is the speed at which emissions are going to be taken out. Certificates are going to be taken out until 2030. And as they are taken out, of course, the price will go up. Okay. So look at two things here. Firstly, the speed with which allowances will accelerate at the same time as the CBAM starts to come in. And then extrapolate this. Okay. Keep going down here. Keep going down here. And you realize that the path of the ETS is that according to it, if it doesn't change, then by 2038, 2039, industry will have to be zero carbon, which means the price of the ETS is going to go up and up and up and up and up. Okay. So because of this system by which the CBAM industry, okay, hydrogen, fertilizer, iron, steel, aluminium, cement, and electricity, okay, will be exposed to the ETS, it means that the ETS is going to start seriously impacting companies. That it has not yet. Okay. So that's the first reason why the Green Deal is really going to start hurting. So the other issue in relation to the CBAM that is really important is it only gives partial protection to EU industry. So the idea, I'm a steel company in the EU. Okay. By 2034, I will have to buy ETS allowances for all my greenhouse gas production. Okay. If I'm importing steel, I will have to buy the same for my imported steel, okay? But here's the problem. I'm a German company. I'm a German steel production. I have to pay the ETS. I will have to pay the ETS for every ton of CO2 produced in the EU. I can't foreign shop. I can't choose where I produce it, okay? If I'm Tata, I can choose where I produce steel in the world that is lowest carbon. So if I produce steel in Greenland, for example, where the greenhouse gas emissions are very low, I can divert my trade patterns and export to the EU from Greenland and use the dirty steel that I used to produce, produce from coal in India. I'll sell that to China. Okay. So the non-EU companies can forum shop, the EU companies can't forum shop. The second problem is that what happens when I'm a steel iron steel company and I want to export? I have to pay the ETS. Okay. Do I get that cost returned as an export rebate when I export? To give me a level playing field with producers in China or America or Saudi Arabia who don't pay a carbon price? And the answer is no. Okay? So I'm reducing my export potential. The third is, what's the objective of the ETS? The objective of the ETS is to increase the price of carbon emissions, so therefore increases the price of the product, obviously. If I have to pay my carbon price in Europe and I don't have to pay it in America, my steel will be more expensive in Europe. Okay, that's why you have the CBAM and the import charge, okay? Which is very good, but then again, that means that the use of steel in European cars is more expensive than the use of steel in American cars or Chinese cars, etc. So there's another competitive disadvantage for European companies, okay? So because of these problems, okay, the objective of the ETS is to increase the price of products in the EU because of carbon charges to get people to reduce the emissions eventually to zero, which by definition requires the EU to accept in the short to medium term a competitive disadvantage compared to producers outside the EU. Tricky as we get to 2034, when these companies will have to pay 100% of the ETS charge, and tricky as we move to 2040, when the ETS says that in principle, all these companies should be zero carbon, in which case the ETS price will go up and up and up and up and up. Okay, so the second issue I'd like to talk about is, so we'll go back to the heat map, okay, is renewable energy. So we have the new Renewable Energy Directive, okay, the RED III, it's down here, the RED III, which as part of the target, so this is the EU Climate Act. The EU Climate Act is a legally binding obligation on the EU to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 55% compared to 1990 by 2030 and to be completely zero carbon by 2050. Now, obviously, the EU cannot take itself to court if it fails to meet this target. But what it does mean, and this one has to remember when one's thinking about what's going to happen between 2030 and 2040, what it does mean is the EU cannot adopt any legislation which is incompatible with this. Otherwise, it'd be illegal. Okay? And NGOs would rightly go to the Court of Justice and say, the EU has adopted legislation which is not compatible with its Climate Act, which is binding on the EU. Okay? So this is really important, not just in 2030, with its 55% greenhouse gas cut, but 2040, where the European Commission, the President, has proposed a 90% greenhouse gas cut by 2040, in order to get to the zero carbon by 2050. So once that becomes part of the Climate Act, that becomes very important. But let's look at the RED III for a moment. So we have a 55% greenhouse gas cut obligation by 2030. And as part of it, the EU has said by 2030, we will achieve that 42.5% of all the energy in all of our energy system. So electricity, buildings, transport, agriculture, industry will be renewable by 2030. It's a big challenge, but unless you do that 42.5%, the 55% greenhouse gas cut legally binding the EU simply doesn't make sense. You're not going to get there. Okay, so roughly speaking, this means that 65% of our electricity system in the whole of the EU will need to be renewable by 2030. Okay, that means the member states have a number of non-binding and binding targets. But what it does mean, and this is something that we can debate later, is in order to achieve this target and the 65% renewable electricity obligation by 2030 target, it will mean that increased prices for electricity land on industry and citizens, because to make that change requires a lot of additional investments in renewable energy, additional investments in changing balancing energy, and additional investments in grids, which in the medium to short term will increase prices for industry of electricity. Question mark. Okay. So time prevents us covering all the other things that one could do, and then looking at how this will impact industry, which in the paper that accompanies this discussion, we go into considerably more detail. But the last thing I'd like to talk about is this introduction, is this side, supply chain governance. So the EU has now adopted a piece of legislation called this, the Corporate Sustainability Due Diligence Directive. What does this do? Essentially, it requires any medium or large size company, so think turnover 500 million euros, something like that. Okay. And if you fall within that category, okay, you will have an obligation to monitor adverse impacts of your activities. And activities means not just what you do, but also your supply chain. So you have to monitor and report on what you do and what your suppliers do and what your suppliers do to ensure that if I'm a shoe production, Adidas in Europe, I have to make sure not only that, but my manufacturing Europe ensures that there are no environmental, human rights, climate negative impacts. Okay, I have to make sure that my suppliers in Asia respect these. And when I identify that they're not respecting these, I have to take action, change my supply chains in order to stop this happening. Okay, so that is potentially a very considerable cost that European companies have that non-European companies don't have. I'm not saying it's wrong. Don't get me wrong here. I'm just saying how it is. Okay, because it's very valuable to do this. That is incontestable. Okay, but it's important to realize what it requires. Okay, so what it means is, so you have to monitor due diligence, your manufacturing, your suppliers. To ensure that there is no negative impacts in terms of, so let's have a look at what the negative impacts are. So this is a slide that indicates what one would. Sorry. What one would need to do. So these are all the issues that you need to check that your manufacturing suppliers and suppliers, okay, are ensuring that they don't have negative effects. Where you find negative effects, you have to report them, and you have to then take action to ensure that they are overcome. You also have to implement a climate and energy plan, where you have a transition plan that is compatible with a Paris 1.5 degree target. So you have to have a target, basically, a plan that will get you carbon zero by 2050. And you don't have to just have a plan which says, okay, we'll do da 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 da. The plan actually has to have measures which shows how you're going to achieve this. Now, if you don't, okay, these are the adverse impacts, violations of human rights and environmental rights. So this is a snapshot, but it is really important, okay? And this is the climate-related obligations. So you have to adopt and put into effect a transition plan for climate change mitigation, okay? So this is really important obligation on industry. And if you don't do this properly, you can be fined, potentially up to 5% of your turnover. And possibly even more importantly, member states have to facilitate civil liability mechanisms that NGOs, people affected, okay, can take you to national courts for failing to meet your obligations. Now, So this is a snapshot. And there are very valid reasons for doing this, but it's important for companies to go into this with open eyes as to what it is. Okay, so what conclusions can we draw from this at the present time? Okay, so the first is that the 55% greenhouse gas cut by 2030 will probably be more or less achieved. Okay, I think we can expect that. Okay, the RED III, the Renewable Energy Directive targets, we'll see how close we are. If you look at the Dutch and the French National Energy and Climate Plan, the Dutch, which is a rich and green country, has a greenhouse gas target of 42.5%. France has a lower than 42.5% target. And we would have hoped, I would have thought, that these rich countries would feel the need to do a bit of the heavy lifting in order to achieve the 42.5%. So it's going to make it difficult. But the thing I would draw from looking at these things together is that the effect on industry is now only just beginning to see itself being realized. And when you project where the ETS is likely to be in 10 years' time, you go, oh, hang on a minute, that is actually quite tricky. When you look at the cost of the CSDDD, the reporting directive I mentioned, you go, that is quite tricky considering that companies outside the EU don't have to do this. I'm not saying we shouldn't do it, don't get me wrong, but we have to realize, and I have seen some discussions where companies say that are active in the EU, but not too active, okay? Because the CSDDD applies to an American company with significant turnover in the EU. So they then have to do this for the American, for Americas, okay? In which case, some of them are saying, well, you know what, we'll close down our European operations, okay? So we should not go into this blindfolded. I'm not saying it's wrong, but we need to go into this clean industrial day with our eyes open. The renewable electricity objectives, and in my opinion, in the medium term, are likely to raise costs for industry. I'm not saying it's wrong. I think it's absolutely right because it will pay off in the long term. But we have to realize that there are very significant challenges down the road. So the clean industrial deal will be tricky, but it will also be very, very important because the least intelligent climate policy is to adopt one, which means that our steel, cement, glass, chemicals industry simply locates outside the EU where they are subject to lower environmental and climate obligations, meaning that we lose jobs, we lose social compact, we lose economic growth, and we globally, we increase climate emissions. So that doesn't make sense. But achieving it when the rest of the world doesn't have carbon pricing is really, really tricky. So on that point, I'd like to bring in Andries and Klaus Dieter into this discussion and start looking a bit forwards, okay? First of all, Andries and Klaus Dieter, it's great to be doing this with you. Thanks so much. Because I honestly can't think of two better people to be posing these questions to, with the possible exception of the President van der Leyen, but my guess is she wouldn't be available today. She might have something else to do today. But we'll ask her for next time. Okay. So let me start with Andries. So you spent a lot of time as commissioner and a lot of time in the academic world. And so you have a great view on questions like, realistically, how can the EU deliver on the clean industrial deal? The president said, in the first 100 days, I will deliver the clean industrial deal. So let's assume, Andries, you're still in your old job, okay? You're still the energy commissioner, okay? And the president has dragged you in and said, Andries, this is your job. Okay, you have to deliver me a clean industrial deal within 100 days that is going to deliver competitiveness in Europe and achieve my climate ambitions. So how would you do that, Andries?
Well, Chris, first of all, I think
I
your
think you're on mute,
report.
Andries.
No, I
No, you're
shouldn't be
fine,
mute.
sorry.
Yeah. So, first of all, I think it's excellent reports that you produce. You really made a good analysis in anticipating things. So, there are some things that are easier to do, and some are always more difficult to do. To write a paper called Clean Industrial Deal, it's not so difficult. You take a Draghi report, take a letter report, and put it in the report, and you answered formally on the questions you raised. So this is what we have. But I think it's more important really is to focus on actions that really answers to the challenges that you indicated. I assume that we are in a situation where we are, that we have used to think that the world will be evolving in the direction we would like Europe to evolve. So less carbon, less geopolitical tension, and more real trade. And we have seen that the world have changed differently. So that means that at least from the Commission side for the next mandate is very clearly is indicated that the real issue is related to industry. First of all, for clean tech industry, and second, for the industries that we call energy intensive industry. For energy intensive industry, and the name of our documents that need to produce this Industrial Decarbonization Accelerator Act, perhaps it's less difficult. Because first of all, we have CCS, and now in a mandate that is given to the commissioner designate, CCS has very high priority. And we see also development in Ravenna, we have in Netherlands. So if you go consistency, you provide at least one pathway to decarbonize and keep our competitiveness towards imports, not fully answering your questions that you raised, but at least you provide one on option. The other options that already has happened is a state aid really to invest in alternative technologies. So the issue is that you have a problem because it's very much national aid and you need to make it more European aid. So that is a second direction, how much you could make system more consistent that provides an alternative technology besides CCS. So for existing, that I would say it is directions that we have. So provide state aid, build networks, and anticipate that you can deal with carbon. More challenging is so-called clean tech. Here are more structural challenges that we have had until now. And that's definitely need to be addressed, investors innovation. That is one thing that need to be dealt with. Then you really need to think how from you move from innovation phase to production phase. And again, I come to the conclusion that you will have a lot of state guarantees. The transition that we are going, it's not market driven. It is driven by political considerations to stop global warming and to have a decent relationship in all value chains that are related to industry. So that would mean that you need to go into that. And so here I do agree that what Draghi has said, Draghi says, well, you need a debt because you already made commitment. And it's true, when you make commitment, you need to understand what does it will cost at the end. So I would say then you need to put all these two elements, protection is existing, where I would say very clear pathways exist, and then to deal with structural imbalances for clean tech and expect that it's all work, because it could work well only if you make it more European. So the answer is more European, and we know that always there we have tension between member states, and this drive to not even changing treaty could be challenging. But at least Commission could put it on the table, discuss, and let's see how we will proceed, because there is no plan B. We have only plan A to deliver. So that means that you should be as bold as possible, and then diluting will come if things will go well. If things will go badly, as was with the situation with the Russian crisis, European Union has taken a quite decent decision. So it depends how stressed we will be. And I believe that your analysis is sober and correct, and we will be very stressed the moment we will really go in this moving away from free allowances. That's inevitable. Because the logic of the whole construction, here I will end, we followed this 2020-20 target, the model that you and I was around. So, and 20% is not 55%. So that's where the difference is. And you build the same scheme around and it does not work anymore. So that I think is important to understand, that if you don't really have flanking measures, you don't get it. And so that means this decarbonization drive should be very much supported or actually transformed on this Clean Industrial Act or Clean Industrial Deal.
Andrew, so that is actually a really good point that I hadn't thought about, which is, okay, so in, was it 1998, 1999, the framework was done for 2020, so the 2020-20 targets. And if you look at the measures that were put in place to achieve the 20%, they're basically identically the same as what has been put in place to achieve the 55%, but the numbers changed. And as you say, the challenge of doing a 20% target is way different from 55, which is way different from a 90%. The difference between, because to achieve 90% greenhouse gas means that all your industry has to be decarbonized, your electricity system has to be decarbonized, because for the remaining 10%, you need that for buildings, aviation, transport, agriculture. There's just, the numbers simply don't add up otherwise. So the question I think is also worth asking is the model that was developed in 1996 to do a 20% the right one for 2040? But Klaus Dieter, if I could come to you, because everybody in DG Energy knows, nobody outside, that if you were still in your post as Deputy Director General, the Director General would go, oh, hang on a minute, the President has just asked me to do this clean industrial deal. Klaus Dieter, could you come to my office, please? Because I've got a job for you. Okay. Everybody knows that's what would have happened. Okay. And so I think you're probably still the best placed person to say, okay, now I'm back in DG Energy. I've got to do DG Energy's part of the clean industrial deal. How would you fill in that paper? And also the, what was it called again? The Industrial Decarbonization Accelerator Act or something like that. So
it's called the Industrial Decarbonization Accelerator Act.
Okay. And that's not within the 100 days. That's the follow-up too. So we can expect that in mid-end of 2025, I would expect. And that would probably be one of the big showcases for the Commission. So Klaus Dieter, I'm sorry to say that you are reinstated in your post and you have to go back to the Commission. But so what would you do?
Thanks, Chris. First of all, that's exactly the reason why I'm so happy that I'm not in the Commission anymore. Let me try. I mean, first I would like to remind us that we have already first regulatory initiatives in place. We have the Net Zero Industry Act, we have the Critical Raw Material Act, we have the Circular Economy Act, you have mentioned it, the CBAM in place, and we had recently also an electricity market design reform. So this, in my view, comes already under the Clean Industrial Deal, because these acts also try to alleviate a bit the problems that industry is facing. But of course, more is needed. And here, first of all, I would like to confirm what Andris has just said, but with a certain nuance. Because, of course, I agree with Andris that state aid and a lot of EU funding is necessary in order to finance all the actions that are needed. But I would warn that we should not go into the trap that we now need subsidy-driven sectoral interventions. That will not be the way in order to achieve the targets. What we need is to focus on structural changes that lead to a truly integrated European energy system. What would be some cornerstones I would mention here? The first definitely is that we should not push individual technologies anymore as we have done in the past, but we need a technology-neutral approach to create markets for zero and low-carbon technologies. For the power sector or generation sector, this could mean setting performance standards related to the carbon intensity of supplied electricity across boards of all energy carriers. For industry, we could imagine to incentivize investments in innovation by rewarding zero and low carbon energy production. That's the first point. The other point, and maybe, and here I fully align with the Draghi report, is infrastructure. Infrastructure today is a significant bottleneck of the energy transition, of industrial competitiveness, and the European energy security and resilience. So investments in renewables will not happen in scenarios where we still have curtailments and negative prices. Decarbonization of demand will not be possible if the renewable energy cannot get to its needs because of the lack of electricity grids. So what we really need here is a complete overhaul of the European grid in a very short period of time. So what does that now mean? We have to look first and foremost into the infrastructure that is covering all the energy carriers that I've said. So it's electricity grid, it is also still natural gas, LNG, it is hydrogen, it is biomethane, biogas, and it is CO2. All this has to be looked at in an integrated manner, not in a silo manner. The transmission and distribution grids have to be renewed, expanded, and also digitalized. And then also one big problem in terms of pricing is the current way of the financing of new construction and also maintenance and expansion of the grids. Because nowadays, these costs are put on the burden of the net users, the grid users, network users. But that, of course, means that the more we are investing into the grids, the higher the prices or the charges for the users. And that will be also increase the energy prices. And that you can see already if you look into the percentage that the grid charges also represent in the energy price. So what we have to do is we have to look into alternative financing methods. And here, one interesting one is the so-called intertemporal cost allocation. That's something where you stretch the charges over a longer period of time. And this is a good method for newly built grids, for instance, for the hydrogen or for the CO2 in future. And Germany has already adopted this method for its hydrogen grid. Another possibility would also go into dynamic network charges, not having the regulated, but also letting that fluctuate. And another one, of course, is that we could also see public-private investment funds. Then a last point that I think is important, because time is of essence here to really achieve a modern grid system for the energy system. And that is we need fast tracking infrastructures, and that needs to be promoted first. And what I mean here, fast tracking infrastructure projects, these are first and foremost interconnectors. We need more interconnectors in order also to create this integrated market. And then also the cross-border flows can also alleviate the problems stemming from the intermittency of the renewables. And the others is, of course, we have to push harder and stronger the development of the North Sea and the Baltic Sea infrastructure development, because without the infrastructure there, the production units will not be built. So this is, and I stop here, these are some ideas where I think now practical actions that Andries has mentioned could start, and that should go under the Clean Industrial Act deal.
Dieter, that was awesome. The Commission can start writing down what you've actually said, and then they'll probably all sleep a lot better because they'll have the draft Clean Industrial Deal. I'd like to pick up two parts. I'm sure we'll get into an awful lot of what the both of you said, but so here's a question. When the decarbonisation process was started, again in 1996, 2020, it was kind of presented as a compact with citizens that, okay, you'll accept that you will have higher charges for your energy and we'll have competitive, but we will have a whole new clean industry. That will be our big industrial policy. We'll have a big industry and growth in clean technology, good jobs. Hasn't really happened, has it? Question mark. PV panels are made in China. Windmills are currently, a lot of them are made by European companies, but whenever you talk to wind developers, cheaper Chinese windmills are always being offered. Electrolyzers, you now see the Chinese, when you talk to people investing in hydrogen projects, you hear that you can buy a less efficient electrolyzer from China at a significant discount to a European produced one. EVs, we all know where we are in relation to EVs. Europe's kind of, so somebody wants explain to me or said that we're putting carbon prices on our industry, on our citizens. The rest of the world isn't doing that. We're playing by the rules in terms of WTO. I mean, the American IRA, Inflation Reduction Act, would not pass the EU state aid rules, let alone what's happening in China. Okay? So, is Europe not being a vegetarian in a world of carnivores, you know, a vegetarian dinosaur in a land of T-Rexes? And shouldn't we actually rethink as part of this clean industrial deal the way that we deal with our trade and protection policy? Because the Net Zero Industry Act is not an instrument that will actually deal with this. So what should we do in order to reinstall this compact with citizens that, okay, we, if not us, if not Europe, who will actually deal with the climate, if we don't show that you can decarbonize your economy in a competitive and socially acceptable way, then who? Then who? If we don't set the example, then who? How do we deal with this, with the fact that we need growth, industry for strategic reasons, and social support for the Green Deal? Andries, I'll throw that one to you first.
That's really difficult. I think the perception in Europe was rather optimistic what will happen in other parts of the world. That's true. Definitely, we expected more actions, and now with next submission process on the Paris Agreement, we will have a moment of truth. So let's see how it will go. Let's not be pessimistic, but let's see what will be in the national determined contribution from US, China, and India. So I think that was one perhaps a mistake. The second, geopolitics have been different and there are resilience and these issues have been not considered enough. Now through the Net Zero Industrial Act, so the Critical Raw Material Act, it's coming back. So it's coming back there. And I would say on this, I would be less worried. The main worry is that we have a weakness of instruments to do such a transition. Because at the end of the day, you can adopt acts and put obligations, put mandates on industry, etc. But the difficulty is that industry always has a couple of options. Oblige to the act, close down second option, or move somewhere else. So you always have this difficulty. And unfortunately, CO2 trading does not provide stability for new type of investment. So that means that we would need really to consider moving back what has done US on taxation. I found very interesting attempt by Commission's president for mission in emissions letter to Commission designate for climate net zero and clean growth that he is responsible for taxation. That's new. And the idea is if you don't go there with tax breaks on Europe-wide, it's very difficult to build business model for new investment. And this somehow we overlooked, I believe, or we have been naive that it will happen anyhow. And it did not happen. Industry lived well, accepting the rules, true. They have had some pressure, but they have been efficient. But with the increase now of certificates that we'll need by, they will be in different areas. So I believe we need really to consider the instruments. And whatever instruments we consider, if it's not Europe-wide, we have a problem. So it is internal competitions that we build, unfortunately, and we have not so much resources. If you use Germany, Spain, Italy, Latvia, all these instruments together will be always by far more needed than if it be Europe-wide instrument. And which form it takes? Well, it could be like a grant mechanisms or grant lines, or it could be some type of tax holidays. And I think for new commissioner for climate, he has these avenues to find how to finance a transition that we keep resilient enough and competitive enough. So it's not the only pathways that it needs to be built, but I think at least there is anticipation that something need to be looked on taxation. And that provides the most of stability in it. Is it naive to do this? Well, then say something better. If there is something better, then you can do it. But at the end of the day, you raise money through taxation. You give stability also through taxation. So that means that it's very difficult avenue, but you need to go it. Because if you don't go there, you are exposed to external competition. And then the options that you would say, well, we decarbonize, but we deindustrialize, does not keep any sense because of resilience and security. So that is the answer somehow that we would say, well, industry have been lazy. That is always the argument is. Well, they have been lazy because they have not been enough incentives. So that you could argue. Then you also have not talked too much, but industry is never jumping ahead of the time. So they need really some type of guarantee or stability to jump somewhere at all when they consider. And then I think that needs to be considered what you will build as a stable instrument that guarantees a transition and guarantee resilience and security. We have by far more challenging time compared when I was in the commission. So triangle now has changed for something that has by far more angles in energy policy. Even
that is Really interesting. I'll just add something, then pass the floor to you, Dieter, if that's okay.
No, it's fine.
That is, for me at least, really, really interesting. Because, okay, we can argue that, okay, we lost the PV industry, we're losing the EV industry, we might lose the electrolyzer industry, because in China they have, okay, cheaper production costs, but also aid in many respects. State aid that wouldn't pass muster. In the US, you have the Inflation Reduction Act, which is a tax credit. So if I build an electrolyzer, I get a tax credit of X thousand dollars for every kilo or every ton of renewable hydrogen I produce, kilowatt hour of electricity, etc. There's a tradable credit. So from what Andries says, it kind of, if you want to deal with this, how do you do it? You can either put tariffs on imports, you can put quotas, or you can subsidize industry in Europe. You level the playing field. And one way of doing that is to have a European system of tax credits. So whichever country you build it in, if you build an electrolyzer, you get a tax credit that can then be used, which is the American system. And as you say, Andries, it's the first time that Europe has actually raised this question. And actually, if you want a level playing field, not a bad idea. Tricky to get it agreed, but not a bad idea. Klaus-Dieter.
Yeah, I wanted first to answer to Andries. For me, Andries, it is not naive if the EU is continuing at the same pace towards our 2050 decarbonization goal, net zero for the economy. Because for me, and I think maybe that is also understood by our citizens, the costs of not achieving it are increasing steadily. If you look at the recent flooding in Austria, in Czech Republic, in Romania, on the one side, and then the extreme temperatures in southern Europe, higher than 40 degrees. So these are already alarming signals, and we know that. And the costs for mitigation and adaptation to this are much, much higher over the long run than the money that we need now to get this transition done. So for me, it is not an option to slow down the pace and saying, oh, we cannot, Europe cannot be the locomotive alone, and the other countries, they are sitting there and laughing at us and making business on our back. That's not, for me, the option. Therefore, it is important that we get now the implementation of the upcoming Green Industrial Deal right. And you have said a lot of things that are correct. For me, again, it is not only, but also a question of funding. That's, of course, absolutely necessary. And we can discuss the idea that Chris has just mentioned, European tax credits, or bonds, or increase of VAT contribution, or increase of the ET share for certain things. So that's the funding thing. But on the more structural thing, and I come back to that, we need structural measures. Here, in my view, it is important that we first look where could we still have a competitive edge. I agree with Chris, the PV panels is lost. Should we give up on electrolyzers? I'm not so sure, Chris, that we should give up on it. We still have the possibility, but we have to act fast in order to install the manufacturers, et cetera, because the demand for this technology will increase. Or the blades for the windmills, these kind of things. We have to identify where do we still have or can reach a competitive edge compared to our international competitors. And then focusing on that. And that also means that we have, of course, as you rightly said, to introduce some protective measures. That starts with the whole procurement. And France is a good example. I think they have already a good system in place where they integrate also some sort of local content provisions. And we have to do that. We have to protect those areas in which we want to become a leader, technology leader, a bit what we did in the batteries field. But so this is procurement is one thing. Also, I agree fully what you were saying, Chris. We need to use our trade protection policies more efficiently. But here, the example now with the conflict with China, Germany is trying to convince other member states to boycott or to bring the tariffs that the Commission wants to adopt to a fall. This is not the way that national interests are overshadowing the development and the application of European trade protection mechanisms. So these are the things. And last word here, the egoism that is still there, especially when it comes to these, let's say, critical issues like critical raw material access, as an example. Just today, I read that Germany is doing a kind of single approach to it for its own sake and has created a $1 billion fund for a critical raw material. I'm not saying that's wrong, but what I would like to see, as Andris has said, that in these critical areas or structural areas, we have to work Europe-wide, as wide as possible, and not only on an individual path.
Listening to both of you, I see a change in mentality from 5 years ago, 6 years ago, which I think is also reflected by the fact that we're now getting to the serious part of the climate change challenge. We've done the easy bit now. Now it's going to get really tricky. Okay. And until now, back to my carnivore and vegetarian dinosaur analogy, that until now we've been a bit naive about this. And as a consequence, the green industrialization has not developed as we would like with EVs. We haven't had a European, with the benefit of hindsight, we should have had a European major policy and initiative on batteries 8 years ago.
Mm.
But we've done the normal European naive thing of, oh, it'll be okay, or it's too complicated, or et cetera, et cetera. All the state aid rules won't allow it, or this, that, and the other. And I get a sense from both of you, which is something I've shared, is that naivety now has to go away. And we need a concrete, believable, and achievable plan, which involves state guarantees, tax credits, state aid, quotas, tariffs, and the whole lot, like the Americans are doing.
Hmm.
And in a way that, okay, we will achieve this Green Deal, but we're going to do it in a way that benefits Europe, not just everybody else. And that this should be a fundamental and central part of this clean industrial deal, together with the cost-reducing items that you've mentioned, Peter. And I'd like Andries's view on that as well, particularly about... perhaps I can ask you this, Andries, the thing that Adita mentioned, as if we go away from the trade and industry side and we go into, okay, how are we going to get the Green Deal done in a less expensive, in a cost-effective way? And Adita mentioned some really key parts, I thought, which was sector coupling, I guess we can call it, which is you can combine sector coupling and technology neutrality in a way. Creating an energy system in which we decarbonize in the most efficient way and in the way that benefits Europe the most industrially. Okay. So how do we do that? What should be in it? The second one is grids. I understand that in Spain, particularly the distribution grids and the transmission grids are now in a really tricky position if you want to continue increasing renewable electricity, and the costs of dealing with peak and trough are increasing very quickly. So Spain is a test case, for example, of why the infrastructure challenge really needs to be dealt with now as well. So you have the technology, you have sector coupling, you have grids and infrastructure. So Andres, how do you think this part of the clean industrial deal should look like? So how should the EU do this to achieve cost reductions in the short term? Because Draghi correctly said, okay, our problem is high energy prices as well.
Yeah, yeah. He very clearly says.
Yeah. So how are we going to do this?
In the short term, it's Europeanization. I would give just an example where, in my opinion, Union was successful, where was another from my region were less successful. Union was very successful on interconnecting Baltic countries. It have been isolated. It was common action. Member countries have agreed, but it was commission driven very much, including synchronization. Without commission, perhaps we would be still negotiating. So you really need to define clear-cut priorities, because negative experience, what we have is Rail Baltic. So the project, multi-billion project, was not very much clear who is responsible of three countries. And at least in Latvia, we are in a situation where I don't know when we will finish the project. So. And it is strategically important project related to Green Deal. So what I'm saying is that whenever the Commission provides the general transformation of clean industrial act, so that's what you need. Wow. State aid rules, Europeanization of some tax policies, and you need also to identify priorities. And there are a couple of priorities that we very clearly understand there are. It is electrification of final energy use and massive increase also in electricity production and networks. I would very much focus on this, because you could establish a target. You could really to try really to design milestones where you need to achieve. Because if you don't get there, you are still very much in old system. And then the transition is very difficult. And I believe that the concept that you try to transform every area is very nice. But still, it's very difficult then to follow through. So you really need to have the priority like this Baltic country interconnectivity plans. That was really well thought, well implemented. And there have been member countries that had some different ideas how it should be done. But then you achieved it. So what I would wish really clear priority areas that you follow through in the quest for decarbonization. And we know that our goal is not to be dependent on fossil fuels. So you need to build instruments that you use more renewable energy or nuclear energy. You need to build up what actually Draghi calls for energy costs or electricity supply. But again, you need to look what you would like to achieve. What he says, and I see it is very important message, he says, well, we have always had more higher energy costs, but in recent times, the gap has increased. That's where the problem is. So could we have a target saying that we should be not higher than 50% on US electricity costs? Perhaps it's achievable. So I believe that if you make very clear performance indicators, that really makes or characterize the move to decarbonization and to new industrial situation, then you can be more successful than just shooting in every direction, expecting that it all will come together. And I would close with my the chapter that I'm very, very sad. It's about this national energy and climate plans. I have looked today, and still not all member countries have submitted the plans, including also Spain. I was quite astonished. So that means how you could make transition if the key instrument of government is not even delivered, not even discussed, and it's very difficult to connect. So that means that you need to change the paradigm. You need really to get priorities where commissionhood has a very clear mandate, what needs to be achieved, and also it could be measured, because otherwise it's very, very difficult really to get there. And electricity price is definitely something that is in the mandate. Yeah, but it also should be looked what are the proposals. I was quite astonished about the, well, Klaus Dieter definitely would know better on this single EU energy trading rule book. That's is something interesting. I was never thinking about it. Then central operation of cross-border flow. There are quite good proposals in areas that could help to bring electricity plants. It does not answer, Christopher, what you brought in your report. Your report is more fundamental. It is really essential. It is really survival report, what's an analysis, what we need to do to avoid disaster. And we have such a, we are a rich continent and we have imagination, but we can work for it. But it is good to anticipate things earlier and then to have this credible plan. So for this commission, it's really possible because there are ideas, and Draghi report in my opinion is good, Letta's report is good, so this commission in a way starts in a better situation. And additionally, we close on positive note also for the mandate that President gave to commissioner designates. It's very concrete. I never have seen so concrete mandates. You deliver on this, and that, especially for energy and climate. It's very clearly targeted. The question how it will come all together, that's a different story. But the mandates are very, very clear, and the responsibility is also very, very clear. And to be honest, I think the mandates have been influenced by Draghi report as well.
Yeah. Dieter, whenever one talks about electricity, one turns to Klaus Dieter, who was responsible for the last electricity market design, et cetera, et cetera. And as Andries said, energy costs and keeping electricity costs down and changing the so our electricity grid was built for a different system than we'll have in 10 years. That's clear. Okay. So in terms of the infrastructure, in terms of the trading rules, in terms of congestion, man, the whole lot. Okay. So I think we recognize that we now need to future-proof the electricity system and the grid. And people have talked about a new electricity market design. Draghi mentions a new electricity market design. How would you address this? What would be your priorities?
Again, I would first refer to what has been done already, and that is the reform of this year of the electricity market design. I think there are very important instruments there that will help also to incentivize the construction of new production facilities, etc. So I mentioned here the two ways contracts for difference, which is for me a key instrument, and it has and should be taken up by member states as soon as possible, because I see in this instrument one of the best ways to find a good compromise between the revenue streams that especially renewable producers need to be seen in the long term, and on the other side to keep also the expenditures for the national budgets in check. That's why it is two ways, because if the market price is higher than the strike price that is set, then the companies have to give money back to the national budgets, and this money then should be wisely spent, also reinvested into the energy system. So that's the one. The other is are the power purchase agreements with backed up with state guarantees. We have talked about that. That's also on that side. Also, again, good for the producers, traders, and on the other side also for the users. So these things are there. Where I still see the market design lagging behind is in the flexibility. Because we all want and we need an increase in renewable sources, renewable electricity. But we all know that the wind is not always blowing and the sun is not always shining, notably during the night. So we need backups here. And this is the flexibility. In the last reform, the result only timidly has introduced some elements in the capacity market mechanism and also has encouraged member states who have not yet introduced the capacity market mechanism that they could introduce also flexibility instruments for renewable sources. What I see, it's not enough. It's again, piecemeal. And what we need is a flexibility strategy that again englobes all the flexibility instruments. It starts from aggregation at the household and industrial level. Also, flexibility can be enforced further in the industrial production. We need to open the flexibility to all sources, of course, storage, but all possible sources. This is something where I see still something can be done. And I read an interesting, in a study, an interesting example how industry could make a big step also in terms of reducing the electricity price. The example that was given is if one would avoid the costliest 20% of hours in 2030, this could reduce the power procurement by 20%, and that would lower the wholesale electricity price for industrial companies to around 6 cents per kilowatt hour. So I have not looked whether this example is true, but it comes out of a study. If that is true, then this is a very good example how also from the industrial side, adaptation at the fluctuation in the electricity system can be used in order to bring the prices down. And then maybe let me just answer the question from Andries on the platform. It's interesting because the platform was installed for natural gas under circumstances that were still linked to this brutal invasion of Russia in Ukraine. And that the storage needed to be filled for the winter 22-23. So that was then the reason why this platform was put in place. It was heavily criticized by a number of gas companies, etc. But the results of the two or three rounds of tenders have shown that the participation was big. And at the end of the day, I think it is a useful tool, especially for those companies that have not the capacity to reach out to the global players on the global market to purchase the energy. They can bundle their demand, put it on this platform, and then a bigger piece of demand can be tendered, and then you get the reply. What is important for me is that this should not replace the normal trading. It should be complementary, and it should be voluntary. And especially for companies in the Central and Southeastern Europe, this could be a very, very good tool in order to participate more actively also in the global trade and making use of the advantages of that. That's also the reason why the Commission, and I'm sure that the proposal will come very soon, will extend this platform mechanism. It's already done for LNG. The next will be hydrogen, but it's also already foreseen for critical raw materials and even cables. So we will see this development, and I, under the conditions that I have outlined, support this move because only the big players for the moment have really access to the global market.
There's so much more I'd like to talk about if we had time, which we don't, but let's talk about carbon capture and storage just for 4 minutes, because as Andrew said, this is one of the key points. It seems to me that we've got a chicken and egg situation on carbon capture and storage, that if you put your mind back to what I said about the emissions trading system and the CBAM, by 2034, the steel, cement, fertilizers industry, and possibly more, will be fully exposed to the ETS. So they will have to pay, I don't know, let's say 150 euros a ton by that time. Okay. According to the literature that I read, the only competitive way that many of these companies can save carbon is carbon capture and storage. They can't use renewable hydrogen, they can't use electrification for various reasons. Okay. So you've got a chicken and egg situation, which is until these companies have to pay 150 euros, they won't want to pay for CCS. But if you look at the Porthos project in the Netherlands, which is one of the first big CCS projects, it will take more than 10 years from investment to delivery, from saying, I'll do it, to delivery, okay? From project beginning to delivery, okay? So if we wait until 2034 to start building them, we'll be too late. But at the moment, nobody is going to invest in CCS grids because nobody's going to pay for them. Nobody's going to contract for them today, for in 2034, because they don't know what the ETS price is going to be. They don't know if there can be ETS changes, et cetera, et cetera. So you've got this chicken and egg problem, okay? Which is nobody has any incentive to it. A bit like the hydrogen grids, isn't it? Nobody has the interest to invest in the CCS grid until the CCS price hits 150 and in 24 when everybody's exposed to the ETS. But if the grid isn't ready by then, these companies will have to buy ETS emissions but have no possibility to decarbonize. Stupid policy. Andries, what should be done?
Well, I think here the pathway is very clear, I think. Since Commission adopted industrial carbon management strategy, Germany carbon management strategy with a target to have already something by 2030. And now reading the mandate for Commissioner for Climate, his task is very clear. CCS should be there. So it is so clear formulated that I don't see how it shouldn't be there by 2030. So it's very clear. The point that you have wrote in your recent paper found their way in the mission letter already. Okay, you could always argue, well, once in his good intention, will it come? But I think there is clear understanding on what you said. So that means you need guarantees. You need guarantees, or it should be European guarantees or national state guarantees when you build it. There are a couple of other things that you could, some screws and bolts, but I don't see anything that prevent if you plan where this network should be, you give guarantees and you work on the same approach as Germany has decided towards hydrogen networks. It will happen. I can't say all the details, but that will definitely be there during this mandate. I am slightly puzzled about single market for CO2. What is meant by this? Because for me, ETS is in a way is a market for CO2. But what I understand, it is more how to get all industry all across Europe interested in CCS. So I think it is more how you intellectually connect. Italy has Ravenna hub, but if I take Latvia has no hub, and it would not really store CO2 in its own onshore or offshore. So it would need to transport. There should be some price signal that they bring to Netherlands. So by trucks or by ships, how does it work together? But for me, it is really more now any more political thinking. It's really technical consideration how you do it and how what guarantees you give to the whole thing. This is, for me, it is like the political jump has happened with these mission letters. It could definitely not fly because Parliament could be against it, but I doubt that Parliament will be against it. So it is for Hoekstra, it's just delivery, how to come to it, but it's not about anymore what you try to achieve, but exactly how you build the system of achieving this.
Andries, Klaus-Dieter, thank you so much for joining me in this panel, which I thought was fantastic. I've learned a lot. A month ago, I would have said, it's really tricky to know what the next commission should do to actually deliver on the Clean Industrial Deal. Listening to you two, I now have a big list, and I'm actually quite optimistic that the tools are there for to enable the EU to do it. But it requires the EU to take a different approach than it has. A hard-nosed, focused, evidence-based review of saying, okay, this is really where I've got to go, and this is how I'm going to do it. I'm not just going to go, we'll have a target, we'll have this, we'll have that, but the world has changed. And that the EU now actually has to have, capital letter, a plan. That this is how I'm going to do the grid. This is how I'm going to get industry into Europe. This is how I'm going to make a single capital union. This is how I'm going to deal with all the issues that we discussed. And I've learned a great deal. So thank you very much indeed. It was extremely instructive. And Manuel, I will pass the floor to you for the close. You're on mute, Manuel.
Thank you very much for this interesting debate. We are run out of time, but we have several questions there. Some of them are related with technology and so on. And I'm going to abuse a little with all of you because there are several questions regarding the Draghi's report. And I will ask you if you can some words in 2-3 minutes of your general opinion about the Draghi's report, if you don't mind. Christopher, perhaps you first.
I thought the Draghi report was truly excellent. I think it really does put Europe up against its responsibilities and up against its challenges. It doesn't give all the answers, but certainly in many respects, like really creating a single European market and delivering all the issues that we've discussed today. I think actually what we've discussed today is, I think all three of us have said, yep, the Draghi report is absolutely right. What does it mean in practice? And in a way, I think that's what we've been discussing today. Andries, Klaus-Dieter?
Well, from my side, I fully agree. It's an excellent report. I think I had some doubts at the beginning. Is not the report coming too late? But I changed my mind because actually with now nomination of commissioners, so they definitely will read the report. So that means that they would be in a way captured by the sentiment, and I fully share the sentiment because I love Europe and I would like to love Europe strong and prosperous. So that's, I think, is the driving of it. About the elements there are elements proposed. Are they good or bad? It's two experts to discuss, but it is really as a report that will not die as some other good reports have died when you would say, well, it was good report, let's forget about it. So, and then after a while we discover this. So I think Draghi report will stay for us, I would say for at least the first year of this mandate, but I hope that it will stay for the whole mandate because in a way it will be good to see where we will be on Draghi report indicated issues in 5 years' time. So it's very interesting, at least from research point, it will be definitely followed. But for me, it's really inspirational, but also concrete enough. And I didn't have saw many flaws. I know that some people say that on digital side it's not strong, but for me, I think it's even digital side is quite good. So it will shape Europe for a while, but will it make decisive impact? That's too strong, I think the statement would be.
I can only subscribe to what Andris and Chris have said. When I read through the report, I thought a bit what has happened back in the 90s when the Commission came out with a report of the completion of the internal market. That was a similar report. The only difference is, and that was better last in that report, there was an annex with concrete measures and with timelines, which of course was not what Draghi should do, but what should be the consequence of the Draghi report, those elements that are absolutely necessary, and there are a lot in that report that the responsible new commissioners have to take up and make this extra step and telling these are the measures and these are the timelines that are needed in order to make this happen. And my last word, what I also would like, because Chris has in his summary said something very important. We should not continue only with the target setting. We should also, in my view, introduce a mechanism or a platform where we take stock about the measures and the progress of the measures in terms of the transition, what have they done so far to push the transition, the competitiveness of industry, and also the level of investments in key sectors. Because we cannot only wait that reality shows to us what has worked and what has not worked, what is lagging behind. I think there must be a mechanism where we regularly monitor and measure the progress in these three areas. And yeah, that is, in my view, that what is needed.
Okay, thank you very much. Really interesting debate. Enormous challenges, you know, ahead. So this serious debate is needed. I would like to emphasize one point, and Chris mentioned at the beginning, and it's one of the part of the document that he has written, is that they need to analyze everything in an integrated mode. No, we cannot analyze things separately because it will be a great mistake. This is something that has been analyzing the document written by Christopher, and I think this is really, really important. Well, I believe that you have more than fulfilled the objective of the seminar with the debate, with a great knowledge base debate. And thank you very much for your participation. Thank you very much for all that have been here with us. And I would like to remind that the document is available at the Naturgy Foundation webpage. And I hope that for all of you have been also in really interesting debate. See you next time, and thank you all. Bye.
Bye-bye.